Welcome to Tao Living, the Art of Living podcast with your host, Luke Corletto, where you will be supported to remember that you are the driver and not the vehicle so that you can walk your life in trust. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to this episode of Tao Living podcast, the Art of Living. And today again, I'm blessed to have another special guest, Mr. Nathan Oxenfeld. Nathan is the author of Give Up Your Glasses for Good. And he started Integral Eyesight back in 2013, where he is now a certified Bates Vision Method Improvement Specialist. And this after over a decade of relying on glasses and contacts, he tapped into natural vision improving and healed his own vision. And now this is my perspective, which is, like if I can do that, can I help others, right? So then he dove into work with his teacher to run through the certification process. And for now, over a decade, has been facilitating people to learn how to heal and improve their vision naturally. And I can say that directly because I have personally been working with Nathan over the last couple months. I've tapped into and went through his online course program, which is in depth, highly recommend it. And then doing some one-on-one follow-up calls to tap in some next level mindset, skill set, tools to do that. So first of all, Nathan, thank you and welcome for being here.
Thank you so much, Lou. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you for being here. I'm grateful to have you. Welcome.
Yeah, no, I appreciate the invitation. I've really been looking forward to this, and I've just thoroughly enjoyed our conversations up to this point in our vision lessons and getting your feedback and perspective on this process. So I'm super excited to see what our conversation leads to today. I think people are going to get a lot out of it.
Yeah. And so I'm also going to throw this on there is an aspect of Nathan's character, which is Nathan had he snapped his leg in a snowboarding incident. And has just recently come out of surgery, and he's actually still like under the screen, his legs propped, right? So he's committed to the process. Exactly. Yeah. So, another attribute of this man's character. So just to add that through there. So ladies and gentlemen, why do I have Nathan on the call? This fits so involved in my professional flow and in alignment with the Tao Living, which is we've been misled, quite frankly, lied, right? About one, about self-healing period, right? The whole entire allopathic model is there's something wrong with us, we're broken and we have to be fixed by something or someone outside of us. And it's just a complete lie across the border. Now, here's what's interesting. A lot of people are waking up to the fact and start to trust their body more to do things. What's interesting for me is even amongst healing practitioners, I was sharing this with Nathan the other day, is they teach other people about self-healing, yet some of them are wearing glasses. Now remember this, I'm not making that from a judgment. It's an insight of how deeply rooted the story that we cannot improve our vision, right? So once you're especially like time goes by, you get older, your vision's going to deteriorate, and you will need glasses, right? So it's now an accepted paradigm. And so linking into my personal flow, as I'm coming up on my sixth decade, a few years ago, my near vision started changing, like blurry, right? Well, I tolerated by squinting and staring harder, and my near vision's great, yet far vision's great, yet the near vision was starting to go. Now, I knew it was a story in the sense that it had nothing to do with my age. And so I started looking into, hey, what are ways I can naturally improve? I've heard about eye exercises, but I knew it was deeper than that because of the mind-body connection of which I play in. And the first person I came across was Meir Schneider, somebody you know, Nathan. And I heard his audio program, right? So I started playing with sunning and whatnot, but I didn't commit and I didn't have enough of the insight to take it deeper. Yet I saw change. And then, I dragged it out and tolerated because I just, I'll just blah, blah, blah. Well, it started creeping up more and more in my eyes. Not cool. So I started to look deeper. And then I came across Nathan because initially he was in Asheville, which is really close to me. And I'm like, great, somebody close by. And then when I engaged with him, he had moved from Asheville to Vermont or Maine? Where are you at now?
Yeah, sorry about that. Vermont.
Sorry about that.
Still closer. We could get together in person, but yeah, I'm up
So
in northern Vermont.
Northern Vermont. Yeah, beautiful. So this is like my little backstory, how I came across Nathan's work, right? And I really appreciate. So again, he's got many courses, many episodes and podcasts. He does a lot of free lessons on YouTube, right? So we'll have all these links in the show notes so you can access his work. And so let me quit talking and say, Nathan, a quick backstory, right? So like, okay, as a young man, you know, already wearing contacts and glasses, what caused you to go, hey, I don't want to keep getting greater prescriptions over time, and your own journey of to self-heal and now how you've assisted other people?
Yeah. And I mean, first of all, I think it's just so interesting how many different ways the vision can manifest and kind of, quote, go wrong. The way you described yours, noticing it kind of later in life and having, you know, that sort of issue where your arms aren't long enough, right? Because it's like, I have to hold things farther away to see them clearly. So that's, you know, the farsightedness or presbyopia or hyperopia. And I was dealing with kind of the opposite situation, which was nearsightedness or shortsightedness, myopia. From a very young age, I got my first pair of glasses when I was in elementary school. And so my issue was not up close, it was in the distance. I had perfect vision up close. I could see everything perfectly clear at the near point, but then I couldn't see the board in the front of the classroom in school, things like that. So taking the eye doctors, giving glasses, and at first it was great. You know, it's like, wow, I can see again, I can function and live my life. There were some trade-offs I did notice immediately though. Like, first of all, like my depth perception was affected, like made it feel like I was like 20 feet tall. It was like my legs were really long. Cause I mean, that's just what glasses do. They really change the way the world looks. Although it sharpens it up, it actually diminishes some other visual skills. And I found I was getting very like cautious. Like I used to be a very playful and like wrestle with my friends and like not think about it. But now I have these like dangerous, you know, pieces of glass on my face where like if somebody hit my face, you know, that would injure my eye or hurt. So like I noticed it did actually like change me in the way that I just lived my life and the way I interacted with people and stuff. But I didn't really mind the glasses. And I, like you said, I switched to contacts. So I was wearing contacts every day and I was kind of fine with it all through middle school, high school, college. And it wasn't until I started getting into more natural healing and learning about yoga, meditation, breath work, Qigong. Actually in college, I minored in Asian religion. So with a focus on Eastern religion. So I was very attracted to things like Taoism and these kind of alternate approaches to living that I was used to from growing up. So that started to open me up to these other possibilities. I was changing my diet, my lifestyle. I mean, I used to drink like two or three Coca-Colas a day in high school, and then I like switched to water in college. And so, you know, I was noticing, wow, I'm getting healthier, I'm becoming more flexible. I used to not be able to touch my toes. And so like I was improving all these things, and kind of like you hinted at, I came to this conclusion, like, wait a minute, everything in my body, everything in my mind, everything in my life seems to be healing and getting better and improving and feeling better. But every morning I would open my eyes and everything would be out of focus, you know, and I would be poking my eyeballs, putting pieces of plastic on them to see. And that just started to feel unnatural. I mean, it just felt wrong. But I didn't know there was a natural alternative. So I was like, well, maybe I'll just get laser eye surgery, right? So I don't have to keep using the contacts or the glasses. That was the only other option I was aware of. But luckily I learned about the Bates method before I went through with that. And that was just like a godsend, because it was like, not only was it way less invasive, because laser eye surgery, you know, is an invasive, voluntary surgery that, you know, only lasts so long and doesn't actually lead to permanent improvement in your vision. Most people who get it end up in glasses again later. So that wasn't that attractive anyway. So really attracted to the Bates method, this whole holistic approach to eye care. And a friend of mine introduced it to me and kind of showed me the ropes a little bit, but I just really ran with it and started. I got Meir Schneider's, DVD as well, and just gobbled up as much information as I could through books, and was starting to see some positive change in my vision for the first time ever. Because, well, up to that point, it was just getting worse, worse, worse. My prescription was getting higher and higher, and so to really start to kind of like halt that process. So first of all, I just wanted my vision to not get worse. But then once it stabilized, then it opened me up to, well, what if I can actually make it better? And that was a super novel concept, because you brought up the aging piece, right? There's this very common belief that the older we get, the worse our vision gets, our eyes deteriorate. And it's just sort of this commonly accepted belief that I had. And then when I learned, the Bates method, and he's talking about, Dr. Bates is talking about, well, hey, actually, the older you get, the better your vision can get, just like all these other things we were talking about. So it all these things made a lot of sense, but it was very novel and foreign to me. I was actually pretty skeptical at first. Like, does this really work? I've never heard of this before. I've never seen anybody do any of this stuff before. Why aren't more people talking about this? And I think it might come back to what you said at the beginning of how this has been kind of suppressed, and pretty much most traditional eye doctors will tell you the opposite, that your vision can't improve, that there's nothing you can do except for glasses, contact surgeries. And that's just because that's the world they live in, and that's what they see every day with their patients, like what's happening for me. My vision was getting worse and worse. But yeah, I definitely encourage people to really open up to these new ways of thinking about vision, just like we think about the rest of the body, because the eyes are surrounded by muscles that can either be full of strain and tension. Like, you, I'm really happy you mentioned squinting, because that's one of the things I used to do. Because when I squinted and forced my eyes to try and focus, it did kind of clear it up momentarily.
Temporarily, yeah.
But when I would let go and relax again, it would go blurry again. So it really didn't seem like a sustainable solution. And that was me just straining my eye muscles and making the vision problem worse over time. So the Bates method is all about relaxation and, learning how to actually get those eye muscles to become more flexible and dynamic, so we can focus near, middle, far, everywhere in between more automatically and effortlessly. Because our eyes are like our senses, like our smell and our taste and our touch. And they're, people listening to this right now probably aren't squinting their ears. They're probably not straining their ears to absorb this information. They're just allowing the sound vibrations to enter their ears, vibrate the inner ear canal. The mind interprets that sensory input through the sensory organ, and then we understand what we're hearing. And it's kind of unconscious or subconscious in a sense. I mean, we're conscious of what we're hearing, but that's my favorite thing about the senses and thinking about the eyes like that, of like, why would I want to squint my eyeballs to try and force an involuntary, subconscious, unconscious, automatic phenomenon, when I could just keep everything nice and soft and relaxed, start to learn how to allow the sensory input, the light, come in through the eyes, hit the retina, go through the optic nerves, and then stimulate once again the mind and the visual cortex in the brain to work on developing a vision from back there, as opposed to just doing eye exercises. So that's one big thing I'm really passionate about. Hopefully that'll be a big takeaway for people listening today, is that the Bates method and the things that I teach are actually not eye exercises, because that really is making us think about maybe going to the gym, kind of pumping iron and strengthening the eye muscles, which sometimes can be needed and helpful and beneficial. But in terms of actually transforming the vision and actually seeing more clearly without using glasses and contacts and stuff, that has a lot more to do with the brain and with the mind and the memory and the imagination and the perception, rather than just what's going on physically with the eye organs.
100%. Yeah, so this is something I've shared on the podcast, well, many times, and with clients and students around the world. One of the as you were just talking about, one of the pieces that seems to be challenging for a lot of people, unless they've been studying the body, because of the way it seems to work, right? Our senses, right? I see with my eyes, so it's my eyes that create vision. I feel with my hands, right? I hear with my ears, And none of that's true, right? It's like, what? What do you mean? You don't hear with your ears. Your ear is just an organ of, as Nathan was just describing, to pick up frequencies in the electromagnetic spectrum that are in that vibrational range, and your brain interprets it, right? So it's all about the nerve system. Same with the eyes. The eyes are just an organ to collect light, and the brain, mind, interpret that information. We don't see with our eyes, right? And so it's like, what? I look out. No, you don't, right? And so that alone is our like, huh?
Yeah.
And so this is, you know, what Nathan was just talking about. This is an essential piece, one, to understand of then why vision and the work, as he was just saying, eye exercises alone aren't gonna change it. If you do not go in to do the internal work, right? What's going, and this is the beauty of why I appreciate Nathan's work, and definitely the offset from Dr. Bates' work, which is tapping into the mind-body connection, which is, ooh, like this is when we get into the emotional parts as well. Like, ooh, yep. What am I not wanting to see, right? If it's a close-up issue or out in my future. So all these other pieces start to unpack. And Nathan teaches this and covers this as well. It's like, okay, when did your vision start changing? Like, what happened in your life? Right? It's the same thing I do in my work, which is, okay, this stuff's happening, whatever the stuff is. What happened in your life before it started to show up as a symptom or an effect? Because again, we're not broken. These are messages from our system saying we need to pay attention. Don't shoot it, kill the messenger, listen to the message, engage in the process. So for those that are
watching, putting glasses on is kind of like shooting the messenger, right?
100%, right? It's a crutch. And it feels like you said, right? It's magic. Oh my gosh, I can see clear. Yet, right? So, and I share this with people in different realms. So if you were to sprain your ankle and it's really intense, hey, crutches are nice to get the weight off of that. So you can still move around in the house or outside, right? Yet, if I saw that person within 2 weeks, cool. 6 months, like, dude, you're still in crutches? What's up, right? Yeah. A year later, 2 years later, and you're still in crutches? Something's wrong, right? And so, right, same thing. So for those that are watching on YouTube, you obviously see that. For those that are listening, I'm showing a picture of Dr. Bates's book. The reason I'm showing this is, one of the reasons I reached out to Nathan is because it's an encyclopedia. Right. When I get a book that thick, I'm like, nah, let me go to somebody who's already digested it and give me the sound bites. Right. it's a big book. So, right. You can go buy the book and not only read it, but then take years to distill all that information and then learn to apply it over time. Or you can do what I did, hire somebody who already knows what that is so they can give you the quintessential yumminess and expedite your process. That's my journey and that's what I chose, right? And Nathan's great in that process. So Dr. Bates was the, obviously the originator of the Bates method. He was the pioneer who disrupted, right? Uber disrupted the taxi industry. Airbnb disrupted the hotel industry. And Dr. Bates disrupted the vision industry by helping people to show them that they could heal their vision, their eyesight, right? Tens and tens of thousands of people with like the entire spectrum of craziness and eye issues. And all back online naturally, right? Well, the industry didn't like that because it relies on prescription glasses over time. Consistently, right? Just like the pharmaceutical industry. This drug, next drug, because that's how it makes money, right? Mm-hmm. It's not about getting people well, unfortunately. The model's not meant to get people well. And so something you shared too, which was, I remember both my parents, but also other people, when you mentioned about you didn't say safe. But the difference would happen in your life when you're wearing glasses that you weren't dynamic
kind anymore. Of more like almost hypervigilant or sort of self-protective
right
you know just wasn't Yeah, I was just,
You weren't in your normal flow, right? Yeah.
yeah, just,
So
yeah.
when you shared that, I just something sparked and I remember that some people that wear glasses, right, they might be sitting on their head and I start having a conversation like, hold on a second, let me put on my glasses so I can hear you.
Yeah.
Right? I'm like, huh? Meaning back to it's now affecting not just the way I see, but how I'm interacting with the world, right?
Yeah. Big psychological effect of
Right?
these
100%.
glasses, for sure.
Like when I work with clients that, they are diagnosed with asthma and sometimes when it's really severe and they have their inhalers with them. But the level of, and for those who have breathing issues, the fear of not breathing, right? That's intense. So that safety blanket, I'm like, oh gosh, I can't leave without my inhaler. Wow, right? That's a level of lack of freedom, right? And it doesn't have to be that way. You can completely heal from respiratory issues as well. Anyways, I digress.
Well, you don't actually, because I mean, fear is one of the like main underlying root causes of vision problems, and fear of blindness is in the top three fears shared by humanity, other than fear of death, fear of public speaking, fear of vision loss. Those are like the three big ones. And so, yeah, there's this massive fear of not being able to see something. And that kind of perpetuates the strain, the mental strain that then probably makes the vision blurrier, because we're not addressing the emotional component like you brought up. And it's not always just the emotions themselves, it's not necessarily the fear itself. What I've found over time is it really has a lot to do with the suppression of the fear or the suppression of the emotion. That's what I discovered when I went back and I was like, okay, I got my glasses when I was like 7 or 8 years old. Why? What was going on at that time, 6 months, a year before that. And I was able to pinpoint and identify some very specific fears. And it wasn't the fears themselves, it was the fact that I didn't tell anybody about them. I just bottled them up, and it's not like they just disappeared. They had to go somewhere, and guess where they went? Into my perceptual system, because that's how everything in life passes through the eyes. And then, like you said, that safety blanket, I love that term, because it's a protection mechanism. If the world's not safe, we're going to blur it out. We feel safer if we're not, seeing the threat, or, it actually is a pretty impressive and amazing like adaptation of the human system.
Incredible.
But kind of like you said, with like getting stuck in the crutches, it's not a problem if the vision dips down. It's a problem if we then go to an eye doctor when we're in that state of fear and anxiety, and then they measure that, and that's just a snapshot. Vision is not static and fixed. It's fluid. It changes all the time. But if you go in and get measured when in one of those dips, and they're like, "Ooh, you've got really bad vision. These are going to really help you." And then you put those on, boom, that's starting to kind of lock that in there. Kind of keep you in that state of fear. And even though you're seeing and you're functioning on that way deeper nervous system level, there's still that unexpressed fear that needs to be dealt with. And so when people take their glasses off, a lot of times it comes immediately right up to the surface, and there's that signal again. And then a lot of times people will put their glasses on so they can hear you, or they can think, or they can get back to their kind of normal, what they've gotten used to, which is a lot of fear. But we have these opportunities to process it, release it. So once again, when I improved my vision, I wasn't just doing eye exercises. I was actually processing my childhood fears, and I was clearing these things, even though it had been a long time. It was still there, and it was still affecting my nervous system. And as I dealt with that stuff, the world started looking clearer. I started feeling much safer. And more confident in my own ability to see with my own naked eyes, my own built-in vision system, focusing system, as opposed to, like you said earlier, relying on this external tool or having to always go back to this external authority, the eye doctor, to tell me how to see, which is ironic because every eye doctor I ever saw had poor vision. And it was only when I started working with my vision teacher, Dr. Jerry Ann Tabor, who had really good, clear, healthy, natural vision and didn't use glasses, I was like, oh my gosh, why haven't I seeked out advice from someone who knows how to see without glasses, I've been going to the wrong people. They're stuck in the glasses too, and they're just trying to push that on me. So that's not my vision, right? That's a prescribed artificial eyesight. It's not mine. It was given to me by them. And so I took them off, and then I had an opportunity to reconnect with my true natural vision, which was pretty blurry at first. It was pretty bad. But I had to accept it. This is how the world looks without glasses, and this is what I can start with. This is how I can build from this to then come to a clearer place.
Beautiful. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, what I really love about Nathan's work is, so remember that reality is only inside your cranium. We've been taught to say, well, reality, and we think like out there. No, that's actuality. Reality only exists in your cranium because it's based on your perception. And perception is based on so many other variables. Your culture, your upbringing, your belief systems, what was downloaded into your subconscious before you were seven, past experiences. And so then that's how we see the world, right? We don't see the world the way it is. We see the world the way we are. And that's where the beauty of the vision, either clarity or lack of clarity comes in. Right. And unless you address those components, then your vision cannot change, period. Right. So this is the beauty of Nathan's work is he addresses the entire spectrum. And that's why we get, hence part of it, the title of his work, right? His body of work was Integral Eye Method, right? Because integration, that's healing. We've grown up, well, the accepted model of healthcare has nothing to do with integration. It's symptom treatment. Symptom treatment never gets to resolution. It's just putting on duct tape and shooting the messenger. Resolution creates integration. Integration creates resolution, rather. Integrate, like mathematics, integral means whole, to become whole again. When we're not, then there's a fragmentation and separation, right? Something's out of balance. So when we do any kind of work to really get well and heal, whatever that is, eyesight, any other part of the body, the mind, anything. When you do the essence of the work, then we get resolution, right? And so that's the beauty of this work.
And I'm also I love that. I appreciate that breakdown of the name of my business, Integral Eyesight Improvement, because of that integration piece. Because I did, and you were just talking about whether the vision's, clear or blurry. I feel like in order for me to heal my vision in my eyes, I had to integrate that part of me that saw blurry, as opposed to deny it and just wear the glasses and say, I'm not comfortable with that. I'm gonna just kind of keep it over there and kind of push that aside. And then I took the glasses off and I said, no, I have to really accept this part of myself that can't see. It's very vulnerable, and it had took some time to really accept that and deal with that and heal that, to get to that place of resolution. And I also love the multi meaning of resolution, because it also has to do with like the resolution of an image, high resolution, nice and clear. So the more resolution you have in yourself, the more resolution you see in the image in front of you.
Beautiful. Oh boy, so many things popped that I was going to take off and go down a rabbit hole, but I'll pull back just a second.
It's funny because I mean there's just so much in our language that is like based off of seeing and vision.
Right. Well, because the dominant sense for most people is vision, right? We tend to be a vision dominated, some people auditory, but most people are visually dominant, which is why it's one of the top three fears, right? If I lose this dominant way that I interact with my world, how am I going to function? Yeah, 100%. And so, for again, for the listening audience, you might be going, well, I don't need to listen to this podcast or engage with Nathan. I don't wear glasses. I don't wear glasses either. Never have. Yet, One, I was getting feedback from my environment that something was up because my vision was changing. I'm like, huh, what's up with that? So if you wear glasses or don't wear glasses, there's still benefit to engage in the work. Of course, if you wear glasses, then definitely. If you would choose not to learn how to self-heal and not have to rely on those anymore, tap into this man, right? Tap into his work.
I agree with that. I mean, I'd say the majority of people I work with have already gone down the route of traditional optometry. They've been wearing glasses or contacts, or they've been diagnosed with an eye disease. And that's kind of human nature to start paying attention to something once it's kind of out of balance. So I'm ultra grateful for people like you who kind of take a look ahead of time and have that foresight and kind of say, I wonder if this can be used as more of a prevention method as opposed to just a reversal method. And it's funny you bring this up because I just had a guy here come to fix my hot water heater yesterday, and I missed his call, and he heard my voicemail, which mentions integral eyesight improvement and that kind of thing. So he just started asking me about it, and we were talking, and I asked him, "Do you wear glasses or contacts?" And he's like, "No, I don't. I've never worn them, but I feel like I probably need to soon." And so I was saying the same thing. It's like, oh, you're in like the perfect place to like start doing this right now so that you can totally sidestep that and never need them, or at least push needing them back 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Because it does not have to happen right when you turn 40 or 45. Like that's just one of those myths that have been adopted by the populace. I really appreciate you looping everybody into the process, not just people who are, currently suffering from vision problems.
Well, because that's also the society we live in, right? We wait to treat crime in the electric chair, not in the high chair, right? We live in a reactive society versus a proactive society. And on that note, right? So, ladies and gentlemen, again, our quote unquote accepted healthcare system has disempowered us so greatly that we're taught to wait until we fall apart and then you go seek help. And when you seek help, then it's fix me, right? You take your health in. This is the average scenario. You're taught to take your health in, give it to the expert, they fix it and give it back to you. Well, that doesn't work. One, because they didn't break it, right? You dismantled it, right? So it's not their job to fix it. It's your job to heal it. And you're not a machine, so you can't be fixed anyways, right? So I'm using these terms intentionally. But we act as if, right? Like, hey, I'm a broken carburetor, somebody fix me. It doesn't work that way. You're a dynamic living entity, right? You're a spiritual being having a human experience, and you're not broken. When we have things that are out of balance, those are just signs that we're out of balance, right? So let's learn to listen to the messages, re-engage in the process. And once you get the message, then do the work necessary to create resolution. And voila, right? Then we have healing. So that's another major paradigm for the entirety of humanity to come out of, because we've been taught that, and it's not true, right? But it's a really large money-making system to keep people disempowered.
And I remember asking one of my eye doctors, once I learned about the Bates method, and I was just kind of curious to get their take on this whole thing. And I went in for an eye exam and going through the eye test and everything like that, and then giving me my prescription. And I just asked, why am I myopic? Kind of trying to get some information about the root causes from them. And their response was, your eyeballs are too long. Right, so that's that whole thing about you have a broken part, you have a defective body part, and anatomically speaking, that's not incorrect because typically myopic eyes do, grow, the axial length of the eye is longer than it's supposed to be. But what I loved about Dr. Bates's book and his explanation of myopia, of explaining why I was myopic. He would have said it, he would have probably started the sentence in a similar way of your eyeballs are too long, but instead of saying period, it would be a comma and say your eyeballs are too long because of the mental strain that's causing the tightness of the eyeball, the eye muscles. And there's a lot of things we can do to address that and actually go deeper than just treating the symptoms.
Right.
And
So
so,
to
yeah.
clarify, ladies and gentlemen, it's not your eyeballs are too long because you have a malformation that you were born with. Your eye has been distorted because of the tension and strain that you're carrying in your system. Yeah. Which means
Yeah.
something can be done, right?
Yeah, the eyes are very flexible. I mean, they're literally these soft tissue organs filled with fluid, and they're surrounded by six powerful muscles. And you can imagine if those muscles are kind of chronically tight and tense, they're literally going to bulge the eye out or misshape the eye. Because I also had astigmatism, which causes like a lopsided eye. So I had all kinds of tensions all around my eye organ, which was just squeezing it into the wrong shape, which is going to, if you think about water passing through, I'm sorry, light passing through water, you know how the light refracts
Refraction.
through water. If you look down into a pool or a lake or a pond and you know it looks wavy, right? It's because the light is being refracted differently. So if the eye's being squeezed out of shape the wrong way, then things are going to be out of focus because the light isn't coming to the point on the retina where it's supposed to. So you could either wear the prescription glasses that get the light to focus where it's supposed to, but that's going to keep your eyeball all wonky shaped. And if anything, the glasses almost make it more wonky shaped. So when we take the glasses off or we don't do the glasses and we actually retrain the eye muscles and we work with the perceptual system to build that mental relaxation and the inner vision too, then the eyes literally relax physically and they can reshape and come into that more normal, nice round shape so that the light then actually comes in and refracts correctly. You know, all these vision problems were called refractive errors. So that's what Dr. Bates, you know, before his he changed the name of his book to Perfect Sight Without Glasses. It used to just be called The Cure of Imperfect Sight by Treatment Without Glasses. And so it was a little bit of a mouthful, but it was all about, you know, how do we deal with these refractive errors from within? You know, so it's totally possible. It just takes a little bit of research and also tuning into ourselves and identifying, you know, what are the sources of my strains and tensions? Can I actually feel those tight eye muscles? And what can I do to let them relax and actually find more flexibility and circulation there so that we have that, you know, finding that more normal shape.
Yeah, and so on that note, I remember even the past couple of years interacting with people through my travels, and when this conversation would come up, they're like, "Oh yeah, I heard about those eye exercises," and I did them for a while, but they didn't work for me. And then it's like, "Yes, but you did one small part of the equation because you didn't do the inner work, right?" So again, just like when I work with clients, they're like, "Oh, you know, I did this and this and this, but it didn't work." I'm like, "Okay, great, but that's all the external stuff. You haven't done the internal work, which is where it all begins, because that's where it started, right?" So
Yeah.
until we go to the source of whatever the distortion is, we're not. You're still doing from the outside. Healing is an inside out job, not an outside in job.
And maybe to even like make it even one step more practical, because this can go super duper deep and we can go into the emotional, the psychological, the stuff we've kind of already touched on a little bit, which I love diving into the deep end. But you just remind me of like one of my favorite questions to ask people who say that they have tried something and it didn't work with their eyes. My favorite question is, well, did you do it with your eyes closed? And the most common answer is no. You know, I'm doing it all with my eyes open because I'm trying to improve my eyesight. Why would I close my eyes? I can't see anything with my eyes closed. But when you close your eyes, that is your invitation to go within. Nothing to see out there. Your eyelids are covering your eyeballs. And so you get to look at yourself, you get to look at your memory, and you get to play with your mental pictures and your imagination and your visualization. And you get to listen to yourself and listen to those signals. But honestly, even just doing a vision practice, like a lot of people will do sort of like near to far shifting. You know, you and I are talking about our two different vision conditions, the nearsightedness and the farsightedness. So instead of just staring at one distance all day, a lot of people stare at screens a lot. They, read books a lot, or, they just don't have that flexibility that they once had. So they may like, oh, well, I'll do some near to far shifting. I'll look at my finger and then I'll look out at a tree, and I'll kind of might kind of with your eyes open, it might kind of feel like an eye exercise. It might feel like doing push-ups in a sense. Some people even call it print push-ups. If you like look at something with print on it, you look at it near and then you hold it far. But if you do it with your eyes closed, if your eyes are shut, you just think about something up close. I'm thinking about my dog coming up and licking my face. And then I think about my dog chasing a chipmunk or a squirrel. Now he's running far away. And then I call him back and he runs back to me, and I cuddle him and I pet him, and then he runs farther away. We're getting this near to far adjustment based off the memory and the imagination and the inner vision. You might even feel your eyes moving physically. They might be actually adjusting. You might feel like the sensation of like autofocus in a camera, where the eyes are, there's these little microscopic muscles and tendons and nerves that are kind of firing and adjusting in a different way than if you were just doing it with the eyes open and kind of making it purely a physical thing. And just making that tweak can be extremely transformative to the results that you get. Because after you do that a few times with your eyes closed and you open up, you might actually get a clear flash, which is when you have your glasses off and something that would normally be blurry or out of focus might actually look sharper or clearer or more colorful, or you might just feel more of a sense of connection with it, because that's so much what vision is. I think you said it yourself earlier, this like can eye mind connection, this feeling of not me just looking out at the world, but really feeling like the light is coming in and connecting with me, which just creates a much more vibrant, dynamic, rich visual experience. And so, yeah, that's like one of my favorite things to ask people and to get and to invite people to start playing with their inner vision more, because you're going to get way more results that way than just doing the physical eye exercises.
Beautiful. Yeah, and as you shared that, two things pop for me. One is the aspect that we tend to do with eyes open because eyeballs are just for seeing. Right? I mean, back to that, it's like, well, why would I close my eyes? Because I can't see anything. Right? Not realizing the insight, right? The mind sight. And then the other deeper part, and this is something that I required to work with my clients on a regular basis to remind them, the Joseph Campbell quote, right? The cave we're afraid to go into is the one that holds our answers. And oftentimes people, right, we don't want to go within because that's where the fear is, right? That's where my emotions are that I've stuffed and suppressed, and I don't want to go there. And I remind them that, look, no matter how scary it was, you're still here. That means you've survived, right? Now let's finish the work and don't survive, thrive. Right? Surviving's cool, just surviving is all it is. It's existing. Plus surviving is a state of fear versus let's thrive. And that requires healing, right? Let's now resolve what we stuffed. Cool. Your body gave you some time to say, we got through that, nice, but don't get over it, because that's all you do. You get over it. Let's go through it, right? But getting over stuff, that's all it is, right? Oh, I'm past that. Nah, good luck. Right? Because it will always come up and resurface to go knock, knock. We're not done yet. Yeah,
Can I tell
beautiful.
a quick story from one of my students on that?
Please, please.
So I was inviting one of my students to go into that space, into that cave you mentioned. And not only were her eyes closed, but we were doing the palming practice, which kind of takes this to a next level, where you actually gently cup your hands and place them over your closed eyes. You're not like putting pressure on your eyes. You're just blocking all the light so that it's even a deeper, darker cave to go into. And like you said, a lot of people do have some fear that, of exploring and digging through their own memory bank or their own inner worlds. And so I like to prompt people with some nice, relaxing imagery to kind of give them a new experience with that. So I had one of my students who lived in the Isle of Man. I had her remember a vacation she took in the south of France or the French countryside, and she was picturing these rolling green hills and those iconic, tall trees, real thin, narrow trees, all these vineyards everywhere. And it was sounded very relaxing. But all of a sudden she kind of like put her hands down and opened her eyes. And I asked her, what happened? And she was like, oh, like all of a sudden these like ginormous bugs started scouring the landscape. They came into the scene, they started eating all the grapes and destroying all the vineyards, and it was like kind of scary. And so I wanted to come out of that. And I knew that this woman, for her profession, she's a botanist. And so I kind of leaned into this a little bit, and I was like, well, hey, wait a minute, like, don't you kind of like looking at plants and insect life and kind of like getting close to nature and connecting with that kind of stuff? She was like, yeah, I mean, I think so. But that didn't feel comfortable and relaxing. And I was like, well, let's go back there. Let's invite the bugs back. We'll go back into palming, go back to the countryside, let the bugs come in and do their thing. And when they were done destroying the scene, the bugs left, and she was left in this state of ultra peace, and just this, probably exactly what you just said. Instead of just like going over it, it was like, no, let's go through it, see what happens. I'm still here. I've survived. Everything's okay. I'm safe. And now, probably what happened is some, old chronic tension or strain melted away. And when she came out of palming, she was farsighted as well. So she came out of palming, and the screen was significantly clearer and easier to see because she had just processed that and gone through it, as opposed to always keeping it kind of at bay.
Beautiful. And a recognition of how quick we can heal, right? Like she goes through that as you guided her, and then when she opens back up again, it's like, oh, I can see. Didn't take 16 months, right? Like boom, right? So all of us have that same capacity. There's something a visual pop that I have shared many times in the past. And then, so for the listening audience, Ray Charles, right? The great musician, the pa pianist,
He's
singer.
blind, by the way.
Yeah. Well, a lot of things that people don't know about his story, they just know Ray and his music. He wasn't born blind. He had an experience when he was young, right? And here's the power of this, because it was a non-physical experience. He watched his younger brother drowned in a tub, and he was at first they were playing, and the boy slipped and fell in the tub and drowned. Well, when his mom came out and saw that the boy drowned, she turned at him and said, "Why didn't you save him?" Within 6 months, he started losing his eyesight, and within a year, it was gone. So back then they called it hysterical blindness. Funny enough, they don't use the term anymore, right?
Yeah,
Because it
no,
actually
that
was
shows up
accurate.
in some of Dr. Bates's writings too from 100
Oh,
years ago. Temporary
but
blindness,
it's a great
hysterical.
term, right? Hysterical blindness, meaning I freaked myself out and I took away my own vision versus some kind of disease state, right? Like, no, there's information in that. At least it was an accurate term. So I share that with listening audiences. So here's somebody who did not receive a physical trauma, but experienced a psychological, emotional trauma and was so great, right? My mother blames me for my brother's death. I just don't want to see that, right? Boom. So on smaller scales, what have we done, right? What have you and I done from something in our life that we encountered and we've changed our vision? So that's the piece. Until that gets handled, the vision, no matter what you keep putting out here, it's that never gets handled. So it will keep getting it's always there, and it'll keep getting weaker and weaker and weaker. Yeah. Doing this work is the complete opposite. You eventually address that, it gets handled, and now everything gets stronger and stronger and stronger. Yeah.
And if that's one of the more on the more extreme end of the spectrum, I love how Dr. Bates also talked about the other end of the spectrum of even how just telling a white lie can make your vision blurry temporarily. And he literally did this with his ophthalmological tools, his retinoscope. So he would be observing people's refractive error state so he could tell whether they were myopic or presbyopic, depending on the shape of the eye looking through the instrument. And he did a lot of work with kids, and so he had children in his office, and he would essentially ask people to tell the truth. So he would, say, please say your name, first name, middle initial, last name, and age. And then he would ask them, okay, this time tell me the wrong middle initial and tell me you're a year older than you really are. And when, yeah, those little moments when, they said their true name and then the false initial, true name, false age, it would go from normal sight, refractive error, normal sight, refractive error. And it was so subtle that these kids probably didn't even notice it. It was such a slight little fluctuation, but it could be detected with the instruments. And that's one of the, all of this research he did was all very experiential and experimental, based off of just working with people directly and coming up with these new discoveries of how intricately the mind and the mental state has a direct influence on the physical sight. And it's not that age and genes and things don't have any influence on the eye health and the eyesight, but Bates just put way more on the whole functional side of it and the fact that, not only every single, word we say in the level of truth or dishonesty to it, but even our thoughts affect our sight. And it's this roller coaster of, clear, blurry, every time the eyes blink and move, a refractive error manifests, but it can dissipate immediately if we're relaxed. But if we have a lot of strain and we're telling all these lies and stuff, like, that's a lot of little miniature refractive errors that all build up and then kind of get sort of stuck and then measured and then glasses and that whole thing. So, yeah, that's why I'm glad that you have Bates's book. Just to clarify, that's actually not the that's sort of a revised edition. There is the original version that you can get online for free because it's in the public domain. Like you said, though, at the beginning, it is 100 years old. It's kind of jargony and it's not always the easiest to understand. So I think it is. But that's part of the reason why we started the Better Eyesight podcast 5 years ago, because once a month, Dr. Bates published a monthly magazine called Better Eyesight magazine, and they're much shorter. Each one's only about 10, 12 pages, six, seven, eight short articles in them. So we're sort of resurrecting that. Every month is essentially the 100 year anniversary, because it went from 1919 to 1930. So I started the podcast in 2019. We're going to 2030. And then every month we actually read those magazines word for word. So you actually do get the original source material. But then in between the articles, myself and other vision teachers will discuss it and kind of share more modern examples and explain it in more easy to understand ways. So that's been such an amazing project to bring this work back to the 21st century, and people are getting all kinds of benefits just from listening to the show.
Beautiful. Nathan is also one of the co-founders of the documentary film Vision 2020, From Eyesight to Insight. Great documentary as well. And all of these resources, the podcast, the documentary, you can find these on his site. And again, we'll have the hyperlinks in the show notes. Yeah. So, Nathan, thank you so much for your time. Closing thoughts for the listening audience.
Yeah, I think I wanted to share, partially inspired by the name of your show, The Art of Living. One of the first books I read about natural vision improvement, it's called The Art of Seeing, and it's actually by Aldous Huxley, who wrote Brave New Earth, Brave New World, and Doors of Perception. And he's this like classical American author. And because, like I was just talking about, Dr. Bates's book is pretty thick and outdated language. You know, Dr. Bates was a genius. He was ahead of his time for the vision healing. Whereas Aldous Huxley was a genius as a writer. And Aldous Huxley suffered from a rare vision condition called keratoconus, which is a conical cornea, sort of like an extreme astigmatism. So he had these super thick glasses. He was losing his sight. And he actually ended up working with someone who trained under Dr. Bates, named Margaret Corbett, and totally turned his vision around. And he ended up writing a whole book about the Bates method called The Art of Seeing. And it's, you know, still to this day, one of my number one favorite books on the topic because it's written so well by Aldous Huxley. And it just introduces you to so many of these really important mindsets and also a lot of practical stuff in there too, in terms of like starting to implement some of these vision habits and trying some vision practices in your everyday life. So yeah, I would just kind of I thought that was kind of synchronistic with being on this show today, The Art of Living, The Art of Seeing. And I would just maybe invite people to look into that book as well. It's a good one.
Beautiful. Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, minimally a takeaway from the show, I trust that you'll sit with the possibility that vision, eyesight can be improved, right? If that's a challenge for you, open up to the possibility. For those that realize something's up and you're looking for change, right? Reach out to Nathan. And engage. He's got multiple different ways you can engage in the work, from online to one-on-one, you know, coaching directly, his book, right? Plenty of resources, podcasts, YouTube channel. There's massive amounts of resources to dive into the work. Because you can, and it's doable for sure. So Nathan, thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing your wisdom. Thank you for what you're bringing, you and your community of natural vision teachers that are helping humanity remember that it's possible and giving ways to do that. Yeah, I appreciate that. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in to this episode of the Tao Living Podcast, The Art of Living. Share this with those you know and love, and help us get this message out. And until next time, abundant blessings. Peace. Ciao.
Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Tao Living Podcast, The Art of Living. Now go to loucorletto.com, loucorletto.com, to receive your free training, the operator's manual for your vehicle. See, when you buy a phone, you get a manual. When you buy a car, you get a manual. When you entered your body, no manual. Let me teach you how it's really designed to work. Also, help me help others and share this podcast far and wide, and subscribe so you don't miss a single episode. Until next time, abundant blessings.